Hello, I'm Anna Maria Clement, co-director of Hippocrates Health Institute. Autism is hitting humanity like a tornado. It is estimated that in a few decades, 50% of every child born will be born with some form of autism. We are alarmed by the inactivity by the health field, and we'd like to put spotlight on this epidemic that's happening. And this is our fourth installment in the series of autism.
But when we started to hear a number of years ago the data and statistics on this, it was so alarming that this has been one of my wife's many, many missions to start to bring people to a level of knowledge and understanding that seems to be missing, even with the autistic community globally today.
Kimberly Tice is a, as I introduced earlier, is a speech and language pathologist and a feeding therapist. So she's going to give us some of her input tonight. Welcome.
So I'm here to talk about feeding and what we're feeding our children and how to get healthier foods into them. Specifically when you're dealing with kids on the spectrum, there can be sensory issues going on and extreme aversions to food, and it goes far beyond just picky eating. But the reason this is important is because we eat 5 to 6 times per day, and there's not really too many other things we do that many times a day. And each time, basically, we have an opportunity, you know, where we can give our children proper nutrition and all of the resources that they need to function, and it can lead to their general health, mood, attention. But the question is, you know, how many times are we missing those opportunities? And for each meal, how are you feeling about it at the end? Did they get all the nutrients they needed or the vegetables? And it's difficult, it's challenging. A lot of times parents don't know where to start. So I'm going to briefly go into just a couple of things that I want to touch on with you. Then we're going to go straight into actual feeding therapy techniques. First off, like I said, a lot of our kids on the spectrum really, really are drawn to specific foods. And not just even those specific foods, but also very specific packaging. And parents don't realize this because these foods are on the market, it doesn't mean it's healthy for your child, you know. So some really deceptive ones that I like to touch on each time are fast foods, Goldfish, M&M's, fruit snacks, and Pop-Tarts. And I can tell you, you know, I work at a school for autism, I see these items being in lunch boxes every single day. And you don't realize that not only are they leading to, you know, poor brain function in general, the dyes and the chemicals and the preservatives, those are all cancer-causing and just generally bad for health. So just because it has, you know, a cartoon on it or it looks appropriately packaged for children, it definitely doesn't mean that it's a great option. And I can tell you, I have a 2.5-year-old child that I see he has a very low sugar diet. And some of these items are so high in sugar and they eat more than, you know, triple the daily amount of sugar that we're supposed to have. And I see a huge, huge difference with my own child if he has just a tiny bit of sugar. Really, like, he becomes a different person. So sometimes we don't realize that our kids are already having sensory behaviors or other different, you know, things going on. And what if they didn't have to be like that? Or their behavior be a little bit better just by what we were fueling them with? You know, that's part of the struggle. Just really quickly, I know you guys know so much of nutrition here that I'm not gonna jump into it. I don't know what people's budgets are and everything like that in their own lives, but in all my feeding seminars, I just quickly address organic foods or, you know, as our grandparents call them, foods. If you only have to select some of them, you know, I would point you out to the Dirty Dozen or the Clean 15. Even if you go online, there's lots of different visuals for you to take to the supermarket to help you remember. Just items that if you can't go organic or can't afford for that reason, for, you know, for whichever reason it is, these are the ones that are safer versus not so safe.
You don't discuss this
much. Oh, okay, sure. I didn't want to touch on you guys so much on top of nutrition. So Dirty Dozen are these things that the food that basically have the higher pesticide content. and it's not something you can just wash off. It's inherently within the food that's grown. So your apples, your celery, your cucumbers, cherry tomatoes, grapes, nectarines, sweet bell peppers, hot peppers, potatoes, peaches, snap peas, spinach, strawberry, kale, collard greens. I thought I listed berries on there because I know blueberries is one, but to me it's a problem too because some of them are children's favorite foods, you know. Apples and berries and strawberries, those are a lot of big ones. And it's hard too because in addition to those kind of already being on the dirty dozen, there's a lot of things out there with some of these foods, like, you know, they sell apples that are pre-sliced and then treated with things to make it look fresh so it's easier to put in your child's lunchbox, but it already has a lot of pesticides in it. You probably don't want to go for something like that. But if you had to choose out of the clean 15, some of these are better. Banana used to be on this list. It's not because of its thick outer skin, so I know it kind of keeps coming on and off. But again, if you had to pick something that's not organic, bananas, papayas, pineapples, potatoes, sweet corn, grapefruit, eggplant, asparagus, avocado, cabbage, cantaloupe, cauliflower, kiwi. Those are the ones that have been tested and have the lowest pesticide content of groups. So this is the part that I really wanted to just kind of dive into because I have limited time. I want to get to the important stuff and people's questions. The two things, if you can take away absolutely anything that I'm going to say tonight, the two main things I'm going to ask you to remember are positive reinforcement of your target behaviors and consistency. Because, I mean, if you're going to be starting a new approach and you're going to be introducing food to your child and you're basically starting on a clean slate, if you will, I just want you to kind of remove the guilt that you may have at this point about things that have gone awry. I've had parents come to me and tell me there were screaming matches or there was punishment or there was, you know, just a whole host of horrific things that have happened at their dinner table. And I completely get it. I saw this little meme on the internet and it said mommy in the morning and it was a Barbie doll. And then it said mommy at night and it was a Godzilla with a little apron. But I got where they're coming from as a mom myself because the energy level you have at the day versus nighttime when you're doing dinner and bath and all of that routine, it's really challenging to maintain patience. And now you just want to sit and eat your dinner and your child's having this meltdown. So it's easy to snap and get aggressive with them. But what I'm going to ask you to do is just keep it super, super positive at all times when you're doing this. And you're really going to avoid like the negative behaviors if they're pushing some food around on their plate or they're taking it off or even if they're kind of mouthing off or complaining about the food, you're really going to ignore the negative unless it's like a safety behavior where they're running towards a soap. Okay, you can't ignore that. But like for the most part, when they're doing this, you're going to pretend like kind of like you're dead inside. You're not seeing that because you're just going to reinforce the positive behavior, whether it's it doesn't necessarily have to be eating, by the way. The positive behavior might be like, we're going to take these steps here, and maybe it's, hey, I really like how you're keeping your food on your plate, or I really like how you left that food on there, or I like how you smelled my whatever is on your plate, you know? Consistency is the second and probably the biggest part of this. People come to me all the time and they say, you know, I gave my child broccoli. And they didn't like it. And then the next month we tried it again and they still didn't like it. I can promise you this cannot, when you are presenting fruits and vegetables and any sort of healthy food, it can't be something that is seen just fleeting. And it's here, and now 4 weeks later it's gone, because they're just gonna think that's something that intermittently comes in and out and that it's not something that they have to deal with or face. So it's consistency. The most important thing is that a lot of our kids are stuck on what we call like a white foods diet, processed. You got like chicken nuggets, mac and cheese, pasta, bread, these things, all those kind of like whitish, brownish hand foods. So first of all, a lot of our kids will just have a meltdown from seeing brightly colored foods on their plate. And so that's the consistency piece where it's going to come in for you, because if they're not used to seeing bright colored food on their plate, it's already going to be a challenge. Each day you have to present, so they just get used to this is the norm. And the next thing is choices. This is actually super important for a lot of different topics with parenting, but specifically with feeding, everybody likes choices. So I'm not saying that you're going to get to starting this program and then giving one giant thing of kale and that's it for dinner. It's going to take baby steps and time to get to that, but you should probably always put the preferred item on plate. and a tiny bit of the non-preferred item. And we're gonna go to portion size in a little bit. But if they immediately, if you put, first of all, only one item on the plate, the issue is that now you're in a control situation. So you can just reject it. If you have options on there, that's something you can work with. Everyone has to win, essentially. So how is it that you're gonna get your parenting win? You're going to put the choices on the plate. You're gonna provide 3 to 4 choices each time. There's going to be at least one preferred item. Say your child's preferred item is just bread or something, okay? If you have a huge mountain of that and they can fill up on that, they can ignore all that other stuff, you don't want to do that. You're going to be strategic. You're going to put a small amount of whatever the preferred item is and then the other options so that they're getting exposed to different colors on the plate, and also because then they have a choice now too and they don't feel so limited, like the only thing they can do is say, no, I want this. So choices, consistency, All right, specifically when we're talking about the spectrum, really useful tools are sectioned plates and cutters. Many, many of our kids do not like the food touching. They don't want one item touching the other. They especially do not want a non-preferred item touching a preferred item. That might be a deal breaker. You know, so really, really section plate to your friend. They also make lots of specialty cutters where if you have a child that's really into symmetry, you can basically push this cutter down and everything is a perfect square shape, and some kids really love that, you know. Small portions, this is a huge, huge, huge piece, because if you already don't like broccoli and now there's this giant pile in front of you, it's very intimidating. And you automatically are kind of turned off by it. So definitely small portions, and especially because a lot of our kids with ASD have communication impairments, remember that it's just an opportunity for them to request more, ultimately. So when I say small portions, I mean really, really small. So like, if you have peas, you put 3 peas on there if you have a child who's really, really against a lot of different foods. And, you know, it's a lot easier for them to say, okay, I can leave these 3 peas on my plate than it is to say, I want to leave this whole mountain of stuff right in front of me, you know? And like I said before, we're always including a preferred item because you need that there to have some kind of like a positive interaction. Okay, so again, positivity. We're praising and we're modeling and we're praising. You're going to use whoever you have at the table with you, whether it's your spouse or another sibling, to kind of aid in your ultimate quest here, which is to be positive and to praise the behaviors that you want to see. So if you have a sibling or spouse there, turn around and say, hey, I love how you tried that new food. I like how you tasted it. Or, you know, whatever it is your child's behavior, you can kind of work around there. Whether it's like, I like that you kept it on your plate, or I like that you didn't sit it out, or I like that you used kind of words. Whatever it is, we're just going to keep it super positive, because when we have those battles at the table, it just becomes an aversion, and now you're going to dislike that broccoli that we want about even more. It's like another battle I have to overcome. You can't do the bargaining and the bribing either. I had it on the last slide, and I just didn't touch on that, because then it looks like it is a obstacle to be overcome, and a vegetable isn't an obstacle to be overcome. The real life challenges we have in this vegetable isn't it. So the last part is really hard. As parents, I can attest to this, don't be pushy. It's really tempting to want to sit in front of them and say, how is that? Is it good? Do you like it? Did you smell it? Well, what do you mean you don't like it? Because I worked really hard at making it, your brother's eating it. You really don't want to do that, because if you were in a restaurant and a waiter came up to you and came up every 5 seconds and said, hey, how are you doing? Oh, do you like it? Oh, our chef made it. I think you're really gonna like it. You wouldn't be thrilled. So you can understand how your child's already trying to kind of process this, and it can be really challenging for them. I'm gonna touch on some other things, but I just wanna briefly talk about making it fun, especially because our kids aren't used to bright colors on their plate, but a lot of them are really driven by characters or certain shapes. So I'm just gonna flip through a couple different things I've done, and we're gonna talk about them at the end. I'm really into like making shapes for holidays. So this was like a Valentine's Day for my son. He was into Sesame Street at one point. There was Bert. If you notice, that was all made of fruit. The heart was too. This is just, I wanna show you section plates for options. That's very frequent. Same thing, there are always at least 3 to 4 options, always colors. They have to see that all. But that doesn't mean you can't have fun with it too. This was a 2-year-old birthday party my son went to. We did Daniel Tiger, little fruit cups, but we also had again, just a section played, different shapes of plates to show them different bright colors. I think that one is a beet hummus with cucumbers and some strawberry. And this is actually, these are actually vegan sprinkles for like if you have a birthday kind of situation. They're actually made of vegetables, but sometimes you have kids coming. Understand, I've seen children sometimes that are eating Pop-Tarts 3 times a day. So like you have to have something to bargain with them to get them to a healthier place, you know? Even the orange peels are great. Kids love when you draw on an orange peel. I can make a great jack-o'-lantern on tour on an orange peel, really. Okay, this is the other piece. You really don't want to discourage the playing with their food because there's lots of studies, especially at the toddler level, where they're getting a lot more information from feeling that food with their finger, and they're more comfortable with it by squeezing it, mushing it, because it's not in their mouth, but they really are gaining experience from that, and it's really important. And if you look at, there's really, not even just among ASD kids in our country right now, there's a real downfall in children eating vegetables and healthy foods, and I really think a big part of that is that we are a country of convenience, and so the big thing that's emerged is these go-go squeeze packets, not even just go-go squeeze, just squeeze packets. It's a huge issue. I get why it's convenient because you're like, okay, I can throw you this packet and you're sitting in the car or you're wherever you are. But in reality, it's just applesauce. They are not having the texture of any real vegetable. They are not seeing any vegetables, so they don't even know the color that they are consuming. And it's also not safe because there's a ton of scary stuff they find in those packets all the time. But more importantly, like people think, well, it has spinach or it has kale or whatever. They're not seeing that and they're definitely not having that texture. So it's not the same thing. It's basically like going for applesauce and expecting them to eat a kale leaf, you know? A lot of the research really points to chaining. We're gonna talk about that on the next slide. Let me just really briefly touch on setting and the posture. You really wanna set yourself up for success. You wanna have these positive interactions going on. Trunk support is super important. You need to be sitting upright. Something you can do is roll a towel and wrap around their trunk. The other thing is too, we need foot support. So if your child cannot reach the floor, you could put a stool under them or a small chair or a stack of books, whatever it is. But basically, a lot of our kids have huge vestibular issues. So picture if you went to, I guess like a bar and sat on a stool, okay? And it's like one of those unsteady ones, and then someone blindfolded you and gave you sushi, and you already have poor motor skills, so they gave you the chopsticks too. And they told you, like, really enjoy that experience, you would pretty much be miserable. That's what our kids are going through, essentially, when they aren't seated properly, they're slumped over, their feet are dangling, they don't know where their body is in space, and they already have sensory issues, and now we're asking them, okay, let's put this new food that's non-preferred in your mouth, you know, and this is why we get a lot of kickback. Also, too, I have a lot of my clients who like to, like, get up from the table and run. You know, this doesn't have to be a negative interaction, you don't have to fight with them to get them to the table. When they're hungry, if they start to get up, just pluck the food out of their hand. You could just use a simple, like, from behavior therapy, we're gonna pick like one phrase and go through it all the time because they'll get together really quickly. Like, why do we sit to eat? Oh, we sit to eat. It's not safe, you could choke, and that's kind of it, and they'll just repeat, oh, we sit to eat. And then eventually they'll come back because they do want that food, especially if it's a preferred item. Maybe that's your target. If you wanna work on them first sitting with you, hold off on the other stuff, use just the preferred food. And we're gonna work on just we sit to eat. It's really super important just for safety and also because that'll help increase their social and language communication if they can sit at a meal and have an interaction with someone. Okay. So optimal conditions, we're setting ourselves up for success. We're putting choices on the plate, we're being positive. And also when your child's hungry. Everyone knows like the food smells better when you're hungry, and you know, even if you go to the store while you're hungry, you buy more things. Like, this is really true. Sometimes our kids are loading up on snacks all day long, and if they're not even hungry at all, and we're asking them to sit at the table, that doesn't really make so much sense. Like, we're already kind of, that's where you're setting yourself up for failure. The other thing is too, sensory regulation. If you know they have sensory needs, maybe get a rice bin or a different sensory bin or go jump on the trampoline or take a walk outside so we can get some of those sensory needs regulated first so that you can lead up to a more positive experience at the dinner table. And the last piece is what I started to talk on right now, grazing. It's a problem because some kids, I am a grazer. I like to kind of snack throughout the day. Lots of kiddos love to snack throughout the day. The issue is, I have a huge appetite. I'm a marathon runner, I'm always hungry. My child also happens to be really hungry, so I know I can give him snacks pretty regularly, and he'll still sit down and eat a meal at the dinner table. The issue becomes when they are full from those snacks, and that's especially gonna happen if you have processed foods that are sugary, because that sugar is going to fill them up. So, for sure, if they're a grazer, why don't you slowly work to expand the times between those snacks and those meals. I'm not saying cold turkey one day, that's it, no snacks, and you're going to eat dinner, because that's not going to go well for you either, especially because a lot of our kids are in routines. You can slowly maybe provide a drink, just some water to fill them up a little bit, or maybe you have to move your dinner time a little bit earlier to accommodate when you know they get hungry, but the point is you really want to set yourself up for success. And I guess most importantly what I want to say is just, as you're doing this, please be patient with yourself, because it's really challenging. And a lot of times parents that are dealing with ASD, they're dealing with academic stuff, they're dealing with communication and emotions and poor sleep habits and a whole host of different health issues. So it's understandable how different things kind of fall to the wayside, because there's only so much energy and resources that you have throughout the day that you can spread out. But if you really, really try to do this consistently, I do think you're going to see some success. And the last thing I want to bring up to you is this article that happened to come out. I was like, perfect, because we really need this. This is the Escher, the agency or the institution that certifies me is the American Speech Language Hearing Association. So they produce this publication each month. And this month was a special on autism. But if you go online there, I saw that their Facebook, Instagram, Twitter, it all shared this article. There's a really, really prevalent speech therapist, Melanie is her name. She has a Facebook page called My Munch Bug.
What?
She has, her Facebook page is My Munch Bug. Her name is Melanie. She has an article in the Ashley this month, and it talks all about connecting with your child through cooking. So it doesn't necessarily always have to be a situation where you're sitting at a mealtime and it's really stressful. Maybe your target goal is just spending some time in the kitchen. There's a ton of functional life skills, from picking a recipe to, she talks about, like, then looking up a recipe, selecting your ingredients, going to the store and buying them, and then preparing this whole together, cleaning up. So there are lots of functional life skills you can work on while cooking. And some studies are showing that kids are more likely to taste food when there's not the pressure of a dinner table situation, and it's more like stirring a positive interaction, taste it and see if it needs more salt, or taste it and see if it needs more, you know, whatever ingredient it is that you're using.
Donna, I don't think any of you here have met Donna yet. She comes in from Canada to tell her story for you. So here's Donna.
Thank you. I wish I knew you when I first started this journey. Oh my goodness, that was amazing. Thank you. My own journey starts with my son, and I was one of those fortunate moms who ended up with a son who was diagnosed with autism. And we had done a lot of things before he was diagnosed, which made me kind of not understand what was really happening with him. And I delayed getting him diagnosed, even though I knew something was off. But because I had done so many things that I'm going to share with you, he started changing before my eyes. And for me, I can't help but share the things that have happened to me in my world with you here tonight, or anyone listening to this recording, because it has changed my life. And for those people who now come to me, I'm a holistic health coach, and I work as a holistic approach to autism and other disorders like it. And it is fascinating to me what can happen when you look at the body as a whole system, as opposed to just one part of it having a disorder or a sickness. And the power that we have to choose, and what we have within our hands to make difference in the lives of the people that we love. So just trying to get a car pencil, but I'm going to share with you a little bit about my story in pieces. And so the first thing that I want to share with you is that we stumbled upon doing anything for my son that was different than what Western medical systems told me. And I love doctors, and I don't think that there's, you're ever going to hear me say bad things about them. But what I will say is that they don't know everything. And I think they would tell you the same. And they don't know everything about autism. And they can't, you know, they go to school for a great amount of years, and so they know lots of things. And they helped me with some of these therapies. So they prescribed for my son 40 hours of therapy a week at the age of 5. And he also had to go through things along with that. And about 2 weeks beforehand, I noticed that he had still some bad stomach pain, some digestive issues, and many of these kids do. And so what my sister-in-law told me was that she had gotten her son off of a grain called, the protein of these grains called gluten. Hadn't even heard of this. And this was found in bread. And I don't know about you, but I love bread. So I was really adamant that we were not gonna do that. And so 4 doctors later, who couldn't figure out my son and what was going on with his digestive system, I finally said, okay, I'm gonna try something. Because that's what we do when we're desperate. And so I got rid of gluten. We were already mostly vegan. We were vegan in our house, but outside we were not as strict. And so we ended up being really strict on this gluten thing. And he got worse. His behavior got worse. His digestive issues got worse. His constipation certainly got worse. And so I ended up going to the hospital because he was starting to fever, and I thought maybe he was going septic because it had been days and days and days since he had bowel movement. Now, he's always struggled with constipation, but not like this. Long story short, from there, we had eliminated a lot of stuff. From the x-ray, you saw bowels all the way up inside. Like, you can see it right behind his rib cage, just packed. And when he finally released that, something in him changed. And it made me aware. And so his eye contact started to change. His ability to make different syllables started to change. And so it was about 2 weeks into that we had him diagnosed. And I had asked the doctor, you know, I just got this gluten off of him, and I hadn't even heard of this before. But he started changing, so you know, maybe that's going to help him. Of course, they said no. No, that's not going to do anything for him. And I left that day, and I said, okay, well, I'm not gonna end with this diagnosis. This is not gonna be the end result for my son. And so I went home and I started going on Dr. Google. Anyone know him? Her? And it was fascinating what I came up across, because it's I Googled gluten and autism. And I saw thousands of families like mine who didn't want to end with autism, or who didn't want to end with that being the end result for our kids, and who didn't want to end with just therapy, although therapy is amazing. You heard from someone who, again, I wish I had her in the beginning of this journey. And we need that. We need both sides. It's not just about one answer. It's about all of it, and bring it all together so that we can have a chance at this. And so what I ended up doing was I started talking to people. And what I noticed was that a lot of people were eliminating foods. And we got on that bandwagon. We started eliminating. And it was tough because, as she mentioned, there's a lot of sensory integration disorder going around with these kids. Is that something they catch going around? And my son has sensory integration disorder. And so anything green on my table if he came in the house and he saw something green on our table, he would turn around, scream, run the other direction, and out the door. He was a runner. And so We had to quickly try to figure this all out, and it wasn't an easy road. But I promise you, it's worth it. And so what I realized is it's not just about what you take away from these kids in their diet, it's also about what you're adding with these kids in their diet. Thank you for that applause. I appreciate it, because it was a long road to get there. And so the second part of my journey was that my second-born son ended up getting sick. And he ended up being diagnosed with autoimmune disease. And that's when I met lovely Brian. And I am so indebted to the Hippocrates Health Institute because of what it has done for my family. When I went to him, my son was spilling blood, and not the one who had autism, but my second born, he was spilling blood and protein every time that he urinated, you would see it in the toilet. And he had an autoimmune disease that attacked his kidneys. And I was desperate again because, of course, the doctor, the nephrologist, based on my son's biopsy, had told me that, you know, you need to be on this drug for life. We don't even know if it's going to do anything. Coming out of Johns Hopkins University, one of the side effects of this drug was death. He had to be on it for life. And he said, yeah, we don't really think it's going to do anything, but we hope it delays it by a couple of years. Maybe by that time, maybe there'll be a cure. And I wasn't going to stop there either. And so what I ended up doing was I talked to Brian after a seminar that he came to Canada and spoke for. And I'm so grateful because I talked to him and he took it back and he talked to the team, all of the results that mice had. And one of the things he said was transition into a raw food diet, which was asinine to me at the time. Although I knew that diet made sense, but that was a little extreme. And I thought, I didn't even understand, because that's just so far removed from what everybody in the world seems to be doing. How am I going to do that with these kids? But I knew that, again, I was desperate, and I had to change. And so what I did for one son, I did for the whole family. And so we all went on this journey of a raw food diet. And the transition to get my son eating greens was not an easy choice. I guess we don't have a PowerPoint here. That's okay.
Keep
going. I'm going to keep
going.
What we had to do was not necessarily cater to his emotions. And I'm going to say this again because I think it's really important. My son's future was at stake. Did I care whether or not he wanted to eat greens? No. Although I wish that you were here, and I did, we were very positive. We had many of the same positive approaches. We celebrated every time he even licked a sprout, okay? And that was the transition. But again, it didn't take long. I wouldn't stop it, no. And this is what I see when I talk to many families. How am I going to get my kid to eat this? And I said, if the worst thing that ever happened to you is that your kid hates you because you're making them eat healthy, then you have done a good job as a mom and dad. My kids go to school sometimes and they come home and they're sad. They're sad because they don't get to eat the things that their friends get to eat. But I know that when their friends are reaching my age, they're going to be happy and they're going to thank me. And they're going to say, Mom, you were right. Because all of my friends around me are sick. And mark my words, it's happening today. Their friends are sick. And so emotions to me, when it comes to food, I'm a little bit hard on this one, because a lot of families are saying, okay, you can eat these M&Ms and you can eat these Pop-Tarts because I don't want you to say I hate you. And many of the times it's us parents who say, you know what, I get it, but when my kid says that I hate you, it's bringing back memories of abandonment and rejection for me. So I'm going to do anything that I possibly can to not get abandonment and rejection from my kid. So do you see that this is a whole cycle It's not an easy answer, but it lies with you, Mom and Dad. You are the answer. And I guarantee you that you have a choice. And are you gonna get full recovery like I did? Because I did. Listen, my son, who was diagnosed by a team of psychiatrists and pediatricians at the age of 5, no longer see autism in my child now. And do I promise that for anybody? Absolutely not. But if you can get a better night's sleep, if you can have a child who's not in pain because of the digestive stuff that's going on inside of them, isn't it worth it? Isn't it worth, like, having this fight? Isn't it worth this journey? Because it was for me. And one other thing that I'll mention is, and I can't not talk about this because it has saved my family in so many different ways. And a lot of people are like, okay, Donna, this is great, but in the meantime, what can I do? And I use essential oils for that. The reason I use them is because they are powerful. And what I use them with is things like focus, attention, digestive issues. So if your son or daughter has digestive issues, I just put one or two drops of certain, for me it's a blend called Digestan. And here's the other thing, I work a team up with a company called Otera. I don't trust any other oils but this one, here's why. It's called doTERRA. It's not because these other oils aren't beautiful. D-O-T-E-R-R-A. Because there's a lot of great companies out there, well-meaning companies. It's not because they're bad. So when I say I don't trust them, it's not because I don't trust them because they're bad. But these kids, they don't detox very well. They've got a lot of issues. And this company, doTERRA, is the only company that I know of that even tests for heavy metals that come from the soil into these plants. They are the only company that I know that have a team of scientists that are working effortlessly. How do you say that word? Effortless. It's not an effortless word to say. And they also have places like Duke University who are running studies on their oils right now. Johns Hopkins University are running studies on their oils right now. This is a company that I trust for my son and my family. This is a company that I will use to serve my kids with. So some of the oils that I use, I'll name 5 of them right now. So Serenity is a blend, and that helps for calming. Balance is another blend that helps for grounding. You're kind of, you know how kids just kind of, they're out there, they're flighty, and they don't really seem to be present. And so those two I'll use. For focus and attention, I'll use vetiver, which is a beautiful oil that comes out of Haiti. And I'll also use another blend called Intune. My other son, who has a lot of focus and attention issues and a lot of ADHD similarities, although I haven't got him diagnosed, but the school sure have. And he was all but being kicked out of the school. And they even asked me if I would homeschool him. Yes, they did. My little guy was being kicked. This is not the oldest one, but the other one. And asked me if I'd homeschool him and said, yeah, he's been getting kicked out of class almost every single day. And I said, I have these oils. Why aren't I using them for this reason? And, you know, I'm a mom and life goes on and I've got this going on and that going on. So, but when they asked me to homeschool, well, heck did I start using them. Because I don't want to homeschool again. I've gone down the journey and it was lovely and beautiful, but I'm not there anymore. And I started using them consistently, and that is key for these oils. You can't, it's like a medication. You don't just take a medication once and go, oh, well, it didn't work anymore, so what's happening? You have to be consistent with these oils. So we started using them 3 times a day for 3 days. And ever since then, he hasn't got kicked out of school once. This is the power of the Hippocrates. So actually last month, we came to Hippocrates with my 3 kids and Bring your kids around people who are doing the things that you want to do with them. Bring them around people to influence them. My kids were so influenced by everybody here. And it was one of the most, it was the best thing that I ever did for them, and I wish I did it sooner. I wish I ran. Knowing now what I knew, and I wish I came here. They loved Sprout. They inspired adults. They all eat. We ended up with my son, who had sensory integration disorder. He had mounds of Sprouts up to here on his plate. And he loved them, and my other two as well. We drank every single green juice. Both times, every day. And so this is something that you can do. Is it tough? It can be. Is it worth it? Absolutely. Thank you so much.
Like Dr. Senef thinks by 2025, every other child will have autism, some form of autism. I know. So I walked the 2 miles with everybody. Yeah, and there. Okay, the next. Let's go next. So here, you're
the excellent project goes from early intervention all the way through adults to adulthood. We have private schools for the age groups from kindergarten through high school, and then we have an adult day program. We do therapies, trainings for parents as well as other providers, and our mission is to go through the lifespan and provide lifelong care.
I'm Specialty Needs Coordinator at Beverly Norman Rails Jewish Family Services. We service South Palm Beach County, Boca Raton County. We serve people of all faiths, so you do not have to be Jewish. We offer financial assistance to those qualified. We offer parent and sibling support groups. We offer referral and resources really all over, not just South Palm Beach County, but if I know of a service in West Palm Beach, I'll let someone know that's what we want. And we're just there to support. So whatever you need, please feel free to have it.
And so our board certified behavior analysts go into the homes and work with the children. Our applied behavior, our registered behavior technicians also will go in and work with children. With children between usually about 18 months to up to 20, 21 years old. And,
we offer services in the house. We cover Palm Beach and Broward County. We do everything that entails a behavior analysis, and we cover ages from 2 to 18 years old. We also have a summer program. We have 2 locations in the summer, one in Coral Smith and one in Boca. And it's going to be based on ABA, our summer.
So hi, we're Palm Beach Behavioral Wellness. We're a private practice distributor. We offer an array of services from individual therapy, group therapy, evaluation services, the testing for learning disabilities, developmental disorders, you name it, we do the testing. So we do as young as we call the 0-5 population. So I think our Hippocrates seen is just 6 months and into an older adulthood. And we even offer parenting.
Characters, specifically the ones who do magic. Any questions?
You're welcome.
So,
working holistic? You working with diet? No.
So that just said it all. I mean, they're doing amazing work, but we have to all work together. We all have to work with lifestyle, and you will hear things today, especially of course about a raw food diet, living food diet, the amazing work that can be done with that. So hopefully in future we'll be able to work together, and because we all have so much to give to these children. But, you know, without the lifestyle, without diet, without programs like yours, I also wish you had that when the kids were small. This is something that really works for every parent, really. And I know, of course, texture is a big deal.
for a lot of children with autism, and it has to have a certain texture or it's not going to work. But we can make that happen with raw foods, for sure. So private schools, K-12, using ABA, applied behavioral analysis-based special education model, using iPads, computers, interactive whiteboards, and family support and training. So that's what these schools were all doing. So now, decades ago, a Senate report revealed that 99% of North Americans were deficient in essential nutrients. And iodine, one of the most critical, was reduced by 50% in a 25-year period. The American Academy of Pediatrics urges pregnant and breastfeeding women to supplement with iodine. Sufficient iodine is essential for brain development in fetuses and young children. Linus Pauling Institute states that iodine deficiency during infancy may result in abnormal intellectual development. Vail Cornell Medical College in New York shows a fourfold increase in the risk of autism in children of mothers with severe iodine deficiency. Other deficiencies like selenium, vitamin D, omega 3, B12 are also crucial for brain and thyroid development. So what happens, you know, our soil is so depleted in iodine, and especially when I'm pregnant, you know, I can get very deficient in mineral, and especially iodine. So I need to have more iodine when I'm pregnant. And what's shown, even when I'm nursing, I should have even more than when I'm pregnant. So I'm getting a lot of nourishment from foods, especially if I eat organically grown food, but we also have seaweed. But in today's world, we need more. So we use very much iodine here. We use selenium, we use zinc, and to help our mitochondria, because what you have in every cell is this power, and that's called mitochondria, in every cell in your body. And iodine is number one to keep that in top-notch shape. So if you want for yourself, but if you also want for your child to grow up, you need to feed them more iodine in the form of organically grown vegetables, seaweeds, but also add selenium, iodine, rich food. A lot of nuts have loads of selenium. Brazil nuts are loaded with it, almonds have it. So, you know, we can get it from natural sources, but sometimes we also need to supplement it with supplements. So corporate collusion with government agencies is rampant. Okay? Profit over human health and life seems to be this norm. This is corruption at its wildest level. So here comes wax producer. How many of you saw the movie Waxed? Okay, the producer Dale Bigtree, Brian Clement, attended a medical panel at the Real Truth About Health conference exposing the formidable fraud in the vaccine industry. And here comes a part from that. That was in Orlando. It's something that we've done together with Stephen Short. And it has been an amazing 10-day, totally free conference that you can look up. You can look up Real Truth About Health, and you can look up the previous ones. Next one will be 2018. And there will be in New York, but there will be live stream, so you can see it for free right from there. And I think it will be 3 days this time, next time. So, what about, can we end it? So here is the bass, and then you're gonna hear.
Talking about is, do drugs work? And everyone talking here is talking about drugs and talking about the money-making side of it and how it may be good for a few people but maybe not for the greater whole, and then the interest in manipulating science to benefit the sale of that drug or make it look better than it is. I agree with all of that. But imagine if any one of these products they were talking about, you didn't have a choice. Imagine if you couldn't walk out the door. Every one of these products these people are talking about right now, you can get up and say, you know what, I went to a panel the other day and I heard some very important information and I don't think I need that statin. I don't think I need that psychotropic drug. I'm gonna go ahead and leave your office. The products that I'm talking about and that I'm deeply involved with, we have no choice. Imagine this industry is as corrupt as everybody up here has talked about, that is as interested in money as they're all talking about, could actually mandate products upon you that you wouldn't have a choice. That's what we have with vaccines. And we talk about clinical trials. You know how clinical trials could be manipulated for drugs. We can't even get clinical trials for vaccines. You know why? They say it would be unethical to do them. How perfect. How perfect. So instead of doing the clinical trial and having to manipulate, let's just not do it at all and say it would be unethical to even perform the trial at all. That's what vaccines are doing. And that's just the beginning of it. And you talk about, does a vaccine work? How about the mumps outbreak at Harvard? Every single person in that outbreak this year had gotten two, not one, had gotten their booster for the MMR. And what do we say? What did all the newspapers report? Was the discussion? Not, does the MMR work? The discussion is, do we need a third booster? Imagine this product is mandated on us. When it doesn't work, they ask us to buy another one. I mean, you can't beat that product line. The less it works, the more they're going to make money because they're going to keep charging us to have more and more and more of it. I could go on and on. Let's talk about Vioxx. What's so frustrating about this vaccine issue is that you have Merck that put out a product like Vioxx that they lost in court for having killed over 50,000 people. Some people say that number goes up into the hundreds of thousands, but let's just say they killed 50,000 people. They had to pay a $3 billion fine. And when they were in court, what we saw in their emails, that they literally had internally in their emails, we will seek down the doctors that are calling out Vioxx, and we will hunt them down and destroy them where they live. That was an internal memo inside of Merck. But why is it so hard for us to imagine that this same company, Merck, might have lied on the MMR studies, might be covering up problems with the MMR vaccine that they've created, which is exactly what Dr. William Thompson, the CDC, is saying has happened. But we won't touch that subject. We can all sit here and talk about how dangerous it is, the overprescription of these drugs, and how the tests aren't being done, and the clinical trials aren't being done right. But we can't talk about vaccines because they never lie. Vaccines are the perfectly developed substance for every single person alive. And they're being mandated. And more than mandated, they're now being forced. Forced vaccinations down in California. I don't have a mandate, but I have a choice in. My kids cannot go to school unless I get the entire 72. You want to talk about too many vaccinations? Everyone up here on this table maybe had 5 or 10 vaccinations. My kids have to get 72. Wow. We need to stop this now. I want to get vaccines to the point where I can be involved in this discussion, where I can walk out the door if I don't think it's safe. When I can prove it's not safe, when I can prove it doesn't have efficacy, when I can show you that the mumps outbreak was everybody was vaccinated with it and it did not work. In fact, Merck is in court right now because the mumps strain has never worked and the FDA knew it and they called them out on it. And when they called them out, they went into their labs and they used rabbit blood and they did every other type of thing that the insiders are now telling us happened. Yet still we defend Merck, still we defend vaccines, and we say we cannot, this is the greatest invention of the 20th century, we cannot talk about it. And you want to talk about a drug that's made for a few, but given to all. Look at the HPV vaccine. This is one of the greatest abominations in medicine we have ever seen. We are talking about a virus, HPV, that 95% of all women will clear out of their bodies naturally. But do we care that it's only 5% that perhaps even need this, and out of that 5%, only 5% of them will even get cervical cancer from it? This tiny little group of people that might get cervical cancer from the HPV vaccine, instead we're going to vaccinate every girl in sight and every boy in sight. The CDC wants to vaccinate 9 to 26-year-old boys and girls with the HPV vaccine. And if you go online, you will see paralysis and death and reports that you cannot believe. So horrific the side effects of this vaccine. And all the manipulation of a study, a placebo that was filled with a neurotoxin, aluminum, and all of the junk in placebo, that's not a placebo. No one up here on this table would accept that as a placebo in a single drug test. They want saltwater placebos. That's what we should have in a vaccine. Why are they filling with all the crap except for the virus itself? This is a discussion we really need to be having, and I'm appreciative of the discussion we're having about drugs, but vaccines, we are not getting a choice. And they're being put into our babies, and our children, and our daughters, and our sons, and our mothers, and our grandmothers, and we are getting sicker and sicker and sicker and needing more and more of these drugs we're talking about because they're destroying us. We need to stand up now and fight for our freedom.
You know, the Viad's only the tip of the iceberg. Merck of Germany created the gas during the Second World War. Let's not forget that. Let's not forget these were the people who created the gas. Let's not forget the Supreme Court of the United States took away the ability for American citizens to sue vaccine companies. This is the only country in the world that your Supreme Court that's supposed to protect American citizens took your right away to protect your children, your loved ones.
Debate is not only about vaccines, but I wanted to show you because this was so passionate and you know, this is from a man that used to produce doctors on TV, and he didn't have any interest in this, and it just hit him that he lives in California, his little ones, and it just became this big thing that he had to work with and make a movie that a lot of you have seen, or you can see it on the internet too. So at King's College in London, Dr. Shi and colleagues are conducting sophisticated prenatal brain mapping to reveal altered connectivity in areas of the brain involved in emotions, language, and higher perception. From this, we will better understand the condition of a wide array of brain disorders, including autism. So they actually use MRI on fetuses to see this, to know so much more. So, you know, it's amazing. There's so much going on now. So now you can see amazing. These courageous men are examples of those who have not only lived with autism, but have thrived in spite of it. They spread their message worldwide. One more time, Phil.
Get a little closer for me, guys. Get a little closer. Good. Perfect.
Can you throw him around there?
Thank you. people all want communication.
We should go for a run right now.
Hello?
I'm going to set up the computer. Hello, everyone.
You are telling us that our assumptions are wrong.
On my student, no!
Website, Bridges and Jabbers, and I can spell it for you at the end. I can meet up in the back. They do sell the DVDs. I believe you can also get on Amazon. And the beautiful thing that I think, and I just have to share this with you, Tracy is very big into his artwork. So the way that he supports himself is he sells his artwork. So I thought, well, how fabulous, because I know how much Brian loves me in this for autism. So I called to find out. They're like, $600 a piece. But the artwork is just so beautiful, and that's how he supports himself. And people all over the world are buying his artwork, and that's how he's surviving.
So here comes
Lisa Andrew.
Stephanie
was born in 2005, and he was a perfectly healthy little baby boy. He was born at term. I had no complications during his birth. And he was born almost 8 pounds and 21 3/4 inches long. So we joked that he was almost a small toddler when he was born. And he was so healthy his first year of life. I never took him to the pediatrician for anything other than a well visit. He wasn't ever sick with a cold or an ear infection or anything. And just before his 12-month vaccines were due, I read a magazine article that said there were problems with the MMR vaccine and that this vaccine was created using human fetal tissue. I was concerned, and when I took him to his 12-month well visit, I asked the pediatrician which vaccines he was due to receive, and I was told it was his MMR. I told the pediatrician I was going to refuse that one vaccine based on what I had read. The pediatrician, who had been the chief of staff for Wolfson's Children's Hospital, told me that was a lie, what I read, that it was made up by extremists on the right, and that the vaccine did not contain aborted fetal tissue. I only learned years later that what I read was true. So following Andrew's vaccine, because I was bullied into giving that to him, I was told that he might die or that other children might die of the measles because of my decision, I agreed to allow him to have it. He developed a 104 fever within 24 hours. I called the pediatrician the very next morning, and the nurse told me it was fine. I called back later that afternoon, and I said my son's very lethargic, and the fever continues in spite of giving him Tylenol, which I was told to give him. Now I understand Tylenol is the worst thing I could have given him. And they told me to alternate motrin and Tylenol. Over a period of 4 days, the fever persisted, and I kept being reassured that this was a completely normal reaction to the MR. I finally, on my own, on the fourth day, just took him to the emergency room because something was not right about my son. In the emergency room, they told me that they thought he had a kidney infection because his kidneys were shutting down. He had such a high count of white blood cells in his urine that it could only be a kidney infection, they said. He was given IV antibiotics, which did quell a fever. They sent us home and diagnosed him with an unspecified virus. I went back and followed up with a pediatrician on the next Monday, and they said, oh, he's fine. He probably was a coincidence what happened to him. He picked up some kind of virus that had nothing to do with his vaccine, and I was sent home. From that time, Andrew lost all acquired speech. He used to say mama and dada and baba, and he said memo for Elmo, and he lost all speech. He lost his ability to make eye contact. He began he developed stimming behaviors, shaking his head. Anything that was a wheel, he wanted to spin. He never had hand flapping, but he had many other stimming behaviors. He also developed sensory processing disorder, and he, over the next 6 months to a year, just drifted away into the world of autism. And when I returned for subsequent well checks, I questioned the pediatrician about what was happening to my son. Again, I was told it was normal. At his 2 month check, or 2 year checkup, the pediatrician indicated that she thought he had autism. This was a different pediatrician, but it was a group of doctors in one practice. And I said, I don't know how this could be. There's no history of this in my family. No one, he's never been sick. How can he have regressive autism? And he starts speech therapy. The speech therapist diagnosed him with apraxia. He was given a handheld computer device, and they told me that he would have to learn to use that to speak for him, because by age 3, he still had no acquired speech. Around the age of 3, I met an environmental medicine doctor from Canada, and I won't go into the just the amazing blessing and synchronicity of how I met this doctor, but he told me, look for an environmental medicine doctor. Well, in Ponte Vedra, Florida, there happened to be pediatric partners in Ponte Vedra who had worked with people like Jenny McCarthy to recover her son. And although they had a 3-year waiting list, I was able to get in 3 months by going on their no-show call list. And that doctor, Dr. Julie Buckley, a wonderful data doctor, ran the blood test that no other pediatrician was willing to run. That blood test revealed that my son had, in fact, been infected with measles. He had titers off the charts for measles as well as rubella. But most importantly, his body was still a year later fighting the measles virus. So we began a protocol of supplements like vitamin D and B12 and folate and digestive enzymes, multivitamins. And at one point, Andrew took about 30 supplements a day. And we started a gluten-free, casein-free diet. And I did start to see results very quickly. Within 2 months after that, I was introduced to Dr. Rebecca Carley. She actually was a health educator who had gone through the program at Hippocrates Institute. And prior to that, she had been a surgeon in New York. Her own son had become autistic following vaccination, and that led her into homeopathy. She sent me a protocol for Andrew that included an alkaline diet, and supplements and homeopathics, and she followed the Hippocrates protocol. And I wasn't sure what to do. I pulled up to, my son was in preschool at that point. He was 3, not doing well in preschool at all. They were gonna kick him out any day because he had so many sensory disorders and other problem, behavioral problems. And I wasn't sure what I was going to feed my child. So I said a quick prayer, and then I ran in to pick him up from school. And I had to walk through a storeroom, and I looked up at the top shelf, and the bucket on the top shelf said, total alkalinity. I said, okay, here's my answer. So we started the Hippocrates protocol, focusing on diet and homeopathics and supplements, and I'm really thrilled to tell you that my son is fully recovered from autism. I was once told that he would never speak, he would never go to a normal school, and he would never live independently. And today he speaks, he sings in the choir, he's in the Latin club, he is with his peers on grade level. And not to say he doesn't have struggles, he does struggle with dyslexia, but he's a happy child, and I'm so thrilled for the Hippocrates protocol and what you're teaching through diet, and you can heal children from autism.
So, what do you think? Isn't that amazing? You're here, Donna, you're here, Stephanie. Now, somebody who can pull it together for us, somebody who has a school. Mary Jo, come on up here. Mary Jo is an RN, she's a nurse. And, you know, she has her story, of course, and her son has autism. And she made this amazing school that Ron and I visited a few years ago. And, she's just superwoman all the way. And what she's doing, working holistic.
Thank you. I don't even know that after everyone who has spoken tonight, Donna and Kimberly and the testimonies here, that I could even follow that. Yes, I have been an emergency room nurse for 20 years. So as far as the discussion about vaccines, I've seen more 3 month, 6 month, and 12 month old babies come in, days of fever, not eating, having seizures, and even died. It's everyone's own personal decision, but as parents, we are the gatekeepers to our children, and nothing should pass into or on our children's body without us knowing what it is, what the consequence is, what those responsibilities are. We hold them in here, we protect them, and then they come out, and the world is a savage place, so we have to be very protective. I have three children. The first is typical. He's 19 off college and loving being away. My second boy is 14. He will be 15 next month. And Donna, you have an amazing story. Again, worked in the emergency room, had my whole pregnancy, everything was wonderful. And after each of the vaccines, he had the fever, the vomiting, the diarrhea, not wanting to eat, and aggressive behavior. And it's a horrible thing, almost like Parkinson's, to watch someone who you love disappear right in front of your eyes. I'm Irish. I know you guys, we've had this Irish fighting discussion many times. I wasn't going to go down without a fight. Not me. And to my dying breath is what I say to my son all the time. So because we're Irish, we get the double whammy. And not only is my son autistic, quite severe on the spectrum and nonverbal, he's also deaf. So, like, peeling that onion, it was like, oh, it's just two eye surgeries and glasses, we can do that. And then, oh, he's deaf. That's cool. We'll learn a sign. And then, he's autistic. Really? Okay, that's when the Guinness comes out. but that has wheat, so we had to cut that out. Some of the things that we learn in that journey along the way of all of these years of, I'll look over here, and I love the Dr. Google analogy because I don't know what I wouldn't do at 3 o'clock in the morning if I didn't have that. You know, we look and we search for everything. What can I do? What have I not done? What have I tried and failed? Should I look at it again? I tried the gluten-free diet three times. Three times I failed. Why? Because I started something and didn't know enough about it. One, I didn't know that it takes 8 months to get it out of your body. So after a month of fighting with my child who wanted to eat seven cheese sandwiches, and I gave in because I was tired of making burned out, I failed. So three times I rationalized it in my mind, everything is fine, it's not the weed, it's something else. I lost years. I parked. I parked in the belief that it was just the ABA therapy, because that's what everyone says is what I'm supposed to do, and the speech, and the OT, and the feeding therapy. About the time that he was eight, I left an IEP, and I was back in my I'm going to fight again mode because I've been on this roller coaster. And I felt really empowered. I went into the IEP meeting, and I thought, okay, I'm going to ask for this, this, and this, and I'm going to get it because I'm intending it, and I'm willing it, and I'm justified, and I know why he needs it. And I left with nothing. And I sat in my car, and I cried, and I thought, I am too tired, and he is too young for me to quit. And that was when I decided to open my own school. But I didn't want to be like everyone else. I wanted to be different. And what was going to make it different was not to just take one or two pieces of what the child needed, but to take and make a school that was going to have everything that they needed. Because just like if I gave a cookie and said, give me back the flour, You can't. It's already a whole cookie. So we can't take our child with autism and say, we're going to do 40 hours of ABA, and in about 7 years, they're going to match the pictures, and off you go, 22. So our school, I forgot I had a PowerPoint. God bless y'all. I'm just rambling. So what I wanted to say in the very beginning was that, you know, we all came into the world in much the same way. Our parents had all these hopes and dreams and desires, and then we got the diagnosis, and we were in dismay. And then we make that discovery, and we have this new strength and determination. These are some of my beautiful little children at my school. I love them. And then we say, okay, so what are we going to do now? So you set off on that upward trend of that roller coaster, and you're like, all right, I'm going to go to all these therapies, I'm going to get my insurance, I'm going to get all the papers that I need, the prescriptions. And then you hurry up and you wait, because you're not the only person with a child with autism, and there's a waiting list. That's so awesome. So we waited on some list for several years. And then we go and we search out all these doctors, and we fight for these blood tests and urine tests and stool tests. Now we're starting to learn again. So ABA is good, it's not the only thing. Speech is good, it's not the only thing. Occupational therapy is good, it's not the only thing. What is sensory integration, and how do I turn my house upside down into a gym so that my child's not bouncing off the walls? When we learn all of those things, and then we come back again to the basic, that our child is this biological creature that is multidimensional, that's when we need to look again, what am I missing? Scientists all throughout history have tried to create things, and then they came back when they failed them, and what am I missing? So this is some of the things that we try to look at when we build our school. I love babies. My husband thought we were just hands-free. So when nothing goes right, go left. That are in my case, left or right, left or right. So have we considered how complex the body is? And so from a nursing perspective, this was great. I was like, all right, great, I can, yes, when I talk about the mitochondria, I'm like, the powerhouse of the body, yes. Our kids need so much more. And we are what we eat. So why are we feeding our kids, like you said, Pop-Tarts and M&Ms? And then we wonder why parents are rushing their child into the school in the morning, hurry up, fix my child, be back in 8 hours. They're setting their child not only up for success, our educators are burnout. It's not fair. This is supposed to be a collaborative approach, but parents need to be active. When you send us your child, you have to be an active participant in making your child healthy from a biological standpoint. So you're in this, doing this, right? Just making sure. So what is the difference for our children that was different when we were growing up? Because when we were growing up, we drank water out of a sink or a hose, not plastic bottles. We didn't microwave things, our parents cooked them. And everything that we ate came from either the garden or the market, or the produce, right? We didn't box everything and microwave everything. Pouches, those plastic pouches we choose. We didn't drink them. The Kool-Aid, that was once a week, right? So we have to get back to basics. We have to get back to the garden, to the table. And it's such a wonderful movement now all over the world. There's so many fresh markets everywhere. There's no excuse why we can't get fruits and vegetables and you know, good healthy nuts to put into our body. Stay away from the inside aisle of the grocery store. Look deeper into the body for the questions that you seek to answer. The doctors who are helping us that are out of the mainstream, I know they don't take insurance. I know it's $400 an hour. When was the last time you went to Disney and you didn't shake your head at a $2,000 event? So we have to look and say, where can I find a functional medicine nurse practitioner who perhaps can order the test for me, get the blood results, the urine, and the stool, and then I can take all of those results and go to the damn doctor. Or come to Hippocrates and find out, what kind of a diet can I do? What type of nutrients and supplements is my child lacking? Because from a vitamin level, from a nutritional supplemental level, our children can do better. But we're facing them with failures instead of success when we're piling crap into their body. And the whole toxicity with the constipation. I've seen so many x-rays like that. It's awful. It's awful. There are some really fabulous labs that will look into the body with the stool and the urine. Pinworms, parasites, our kids are loaded with them. when their yeast overgrowth. I don't know if anyone has ever done this, but look into it, these lab tests. If your child has a yeast overgrowth, you've got to reduce and eliminate the sugars and the starchy carbs, all of these rices and pastas and processed foods. You're feeding the yeast. You have to starve out the yeast and change the diet. I have 5 families at my school right now that in the past 1 year have dramatically changed. Gluten-free, casein-free, soy-free, and specific carbohydrate. That's the low carbohydrate. I cannot begin to tell you the amazing stories of recovery that we have started to have with them. My child who is deaf, right, nonverbal, his self-injurious behaviors have almost been completely eliminated. He's making verbalization. His hearing loss wasn't in the cochlea. It's along the auditory nerve. So take into consideration, when we're reducing inflammation in the body, reducing the inflammation in the gut, inflammation is being reduced in his body all over. And I really believe that as we continue to reduce the inflammation systemically, it's taking the pressure off that auditory nerve because he's making a lot of sounds and a lot of words and approximations. We become complacent. We get stuck in our lives and we think that time is on our side, and all of a sudden we go from 1 year to the next and we blink and they're 10 years old. Time is not on our side and we have to be really aggressive. We have to align ourselves with those who can teach us, or with those we can teach and also learn from. So find support groups. Our school has a support group once a month that we meet with. Anyone is welcome to come. You do not have to attend our school. You need to set goals with deadlines to learn about a variety of approaches. Our kids have IEPs with goals and deadlines, specific outcomes. What do we have as parents that keep ourselves accountable? We need to inform ourselves about the services to support you and your child. Find the best school that meets a variety of your child's needs. Free and easy is not always the best choice. Always know why you're doing what you're doing, whether it's a food or a medication or a dietary supplement. Always know why you're doing what you're doing. Our school has a wonderful approach here. At the very top, we have academics. So every child's academic portfolio is individually tailored. We do ABA therapy. We have occupational therapy equipment in every classroom. Kids need to be regulated all throughout the day. They can move from the table to a swing to a trampoline, and it's all in the same classroom. So that they're on, you know, they have the ability to regulate themselves as needed. We do sign language, we do speech therapy. The social skills, we work on independent living skills, athletic programs, and community outings. So we can't wait until they're 18 or 19 and start talking then about vocational skills. We do them from as little as they are, cleaning, wiping things up, putting away chairs, taking out the garbage, folding clothes, washing their dishes, brushing their teeth after meals, they do all of these things. We have, as a nurse, right, I love and respect Western medicine, but as a parent with a child with autism, it nowhere near came close to my needs. And I have a respect for Eastern medicine. I think that the two can complement each other. There are times when my son's yeast overgrowth is high and I need prescription ice down. So Western medicine fits, but not for everything. And certainly we can't always trust our Western medicine doctors to be transparent with us. We have availability and references for families for chiropractic care, laboratory testing, medical and dental. And on the Eastern medicine, every day in the classrooms, I love doTERRA. Where was my doTERRA? Yes. We use doTERRA at our school. We diffuse it in the classrooms. We have half of our student population that uses doTERRA. The parents purchase the oils. We will apply them where and whenever the parents, when they fill out the form. So yes, we have the digestive ones, we have the calming ones, we put vetiver on the feet. It's wonderful. The doTERRA, and I've gone through a bunch of different companies personally, and I chose doTERRA for many of the reasons that you had spoken about. For those of you who are not as informed about doTERRA as you would like to be, our school has an in-service tomorrow. It's free at 3 p.m. You're more than welcome to come, sample, we have gifts and giveaways, and you can learn about doTERRA and the different products that they have. We diffuse those in the classrooms. We have a nutritionist, and we have different blood tests that we can do that tells you the different foods that cause inflammation. And that's an MRT test for anyone from Oxford Bioglyph, and anyone has ever heard of the MRT. I don't know that there's anything else that everyone has spoken such wonderful things, and I encourage everyone on their journey press on, don't give up. It's not going to be easy. Nobody said it was going to be, but as long as your child is here, and they already are, until your dying breath too, we have to continue to fight. We have to continue to try things. I wish you all the very best of luck in your journey.